Email aliases are an amazing tool, but unless you know how to use them well, you end up with the same crowded inbox, only slightly better privacy and no small amount of confusion. It took me a few years, but I finally developed a system that works well for me. And perhaps by seeing how I set up my email aliases and my method to categorize and then anonymize my emails, you'll gather a few ideas and tools that you can implement for yourself. And you'll get to meet my fictitious online alter ego, my fictitious online alter ego, Jason. This is All Things Secured. My name is Josh, and throughout this video, I'm not only gonna explain how I reduce my email spam to pretty much zero at this point, which is one big benefit of email aliases, I'm also gonna share with you how this setup helps me stay organized and provide stronger security for my digital life. I'll finish by giving you a list of the kind of email aliases that I think everybody should be using, including you. This video is sponsored by EasyDMARC, an email security solution for those who own their own domain and want an easier way to manage and monitor their email authentication. I use EasyDMARC to manage the All Things Secured domain, and I can't even begin to tell you how much easier it is for me as a small business owner to analyze my DMARC reports, spot any threats, and then have the confidence of knowing that nobody can impersonate me. And as someone who uses email to communicate with many of you in my audience, I also love the fact that this kind of email authentication increases my domain reputation and, as a result, increases the deliverability of my emails. If you own your own email domain, setting up DMARC protection should be done no matter what. But if you'd like some help, or if you just want to check and see if you've set it up correctly, visit easydmarc.com and type in your URL. They have plans that can work for anybody, and you can get 10% off using the code ATSPROMO. Okay, before we dive in, I want to make sure that you and I are on the same page when it comes to what we're talking about when we say email aliases. An email alias is an email address that's created for a specific purpose. This is different than an email account or an email inbox, which could be the final destination for an infinite number of email aliases. For the purpose of this video, I'm going to use the word inbox to refer to a specific account where emails are received and stored, whereas an alias will refer to a unique email address. Okay, at this point, I probably have hundreds of email aliases. However, I only keep 5 active email inboxes: my personal account, a business account, an end-to-end encrypted account, a fun pseudonym, and finally, an alias account where I create all my anonymous email addresses. Let me explain how each of these work. My personal account is, it's just what it sounds like, it's personal. I don't give this email out to anybody except my family and close friends, which means that any email received in that inbox is important to me. For you, you might have to start from scratch with a new personal email account if your current inbox is already flooded with too much spam. But at one point, I felt the same, and over time, I was able to reclaim that inbox by changing login email addresses and unsubscribing from pretty much every newsletter that I received to that email address. So it is possible. And yes, I did say Gmail account. I could use a more secure email provider here, but I already have this email address, and this isn't sensitive communication. I have other uses for end-to-end encrypted email that I'll explain in a moment. Second is my business account, which is pretty self-explanatory. All business communication happens within that inbox, and I recommend you keep all personal and business email inboxes separated. As a small business owner, I've created a number of different email aliases tied to this inbox, including a payments alias, an advertising alias. I even create a separate email alias for my LinkedIn account so that I can easily disavow and delete that one if I really need to. The next inbox is also one of the most important, my encrypted ProtonMail inbox. I use this account only for secure communication and any financial account logins like my bank or investment accounts. Doing it this way has a few advantages. First, if I receive any kind of finance-related email to one of my other email accounts, I can be fairly confident that it's fraudulent or at least some kind of phishing scam. I'm also making sure that anytime I communicate with my bank or my CPA or my lawyer, that all that communication can't be intercepted and scanned. I pay for my ProtonMail inbox, but that end-to-end encryption is the value that I get from that. This alias and the corresponding inbox are only used for secure communication, period. You're never gonna see me sharing this email alias here, on this channel, or anywhere else online. It is strictly private. Okay, now for my third inbox, which belongs to a gentleman by the name of Jason. Now, I'm bleeping out that full name because the whole point of a pseudonym is to keep it as separated from my real name as possible. Jason has his own email account, his own profile picture, his own phone number, and even his own social media accounts. Now, I'm not gonna go into too much detail about this right now. If you wanna see another video about setting up a fictitious online persona, leave a comment below to let me know. I'm curious if that's of interest to you. What you do need to know is that I use this alias and account in places where I need to give out a name and an email address, but I really don't want to, and I legally don't need to share my actual name and email. The important thing is that this email alias is easy for me to remember, and I rarely, if ever, check this email account. I mean, just last weekend, I went to an event with my family where I had to give over a name, email address, and phone number to participate in this car show and get some free stuff that they were giving out. It had to be a real email address and a phone number, but what they now have is Jason's info, not mine. That's the beauty of aliases. Now, up to this point, I've been sharing a very traditional and somewhat manual approach to email aliases. But if you're interested in aliases and the privacy control that they provide, you've probably already heard about services like AnonAddy or AnonAddy, Apple's Hide My Email, MailDrop, or the one that I use, Simple Login. It's not technically an inbox. It acts more like a triage, but it's still an important part of my strategy. These email alias services work in one of two ways. The first is to create a unique alias for every single login and every single time that I have to give over an email address. You can create these email aliases manually, or most of these services have some kind of integrated extension that allows you to create aliases on the go from your internet browser. In either case, you're creating random aliases that are forwarded to one of your other existing inboxes. At least that's possible within Simple Login. And if these aliases ever become compromised or start generating too much spam, you can simply delete them and start over. Now, I do want to mention that there are plenty of services online that offer to generate temporary email addresses. And these are different from email aliases in that you don't own them and you don't have control over them. They're one-time use only. Perhaps that's of some value to you. Personally, I like to maintain some semblance of control here. This whole alias thing does get tedious though, and I personally don't use a new alias for every single login yet. But you can use these alias services in another way, which leads me to my final recommendation, creating alias groups. I have an email alias that I use specifically for email newsletters that I want to read. I value those newsletters. I have another alias that I use for all social media accounts, another for all content streaming services, another for shopping accounts, and one for general marketing materials. One of the reasons I do this is because when I need to log into my Netflix account on, let's say my TV, the last thing I want to do here is to have to dig into my Simple Login account, find that random email alias that was generated, and then type it in one letter and character at a time. I would rather have that memorable alias that I use for a specific group of accounts. And these groupings aren't all forwarded to the same inbox. The valued newsletters, for example, are forwarded to my personal account, but I use filters to make sure that they skip the inbox and go straight to my newsletters folder. I only check that folder when I have time to read the newsletters, keeping my primary inbox clear of anything except emails from my friends and family. Pretty much every other alias group gets forwarded and lands in Jason's inbox. He's sacrificially taking on all the marketing junk that comes his way so that I don't have to. If you have additional questions about aliases that I haven't addressed here, or if you think I've missed something, I welcome comments below. And if you'd like to learn more about protecting your email, I've compared the four best secure email options here and explained business email security that you can watch next by clicking down here.